So first of all, thank you so much for staying this late. This is not trivial, still a work day. Okay, so I have the honor to be the last speaker for today. I hope you would learn something at the end of this talk. And I'm going to talk about a concept in LLMs, large language models, that I think is the most important part, but the least discussed, or at least it doesn't get enough attention. Is there anyone here who doesn't know ChatGPT, Bard? Cool. So let's do a brief intro. This is our agenda for today. First, we're going to say a few words about us, about me, about Argmax, what do we do, about our clients. Then we are going to drill down into what is RTB, real-time bidding. And we are in Digital Turbine. Digital Turbine makes a living from real-time bidding, so it's worth a while listening to. Then we're going to talk about LLM infrastructure. How are LLMs actually built? Then we're going to dive deep into the decoding algorithm, the most interesting part that I think we have anything to do with, like we're not going to train a transformer, right? And then we're going to share some code, and then we'll part. Okay, so about me, I'm Uri. Some of you know me from the Explainable podcast. I'm also a co-organizer of PyData, and thank you so much for being a part of this huge community. Today, I lead Argmax. Argmax is a consulting firm doing two things, recommendation engines and natural language processing. And we are working with a variety of clients, and roughly you can split them into three verticals, either creator economy, like Artlist and Lightrix in the past, either in the finance, and the majority of our clients are actually doing some sort of advertising, either content creation or real-time bidding. That would be the focus of today's talk. So a word on real-time bidding, and I guess that Yael kind of beat me to that. Essentially, every time you open a browser or a mobile app, there's an auction going on behind the scenes. So a user opens his or her mobile app, and then all of a sudden, he gets an ad. But behind the scenes, there are several players, several bidders, also known as DSPs, demand-side platforms, who are trying to bid. For example, if a bidder, a DSP, is trying to advertise a dating app, and the user is age 20, he might bid. If the user is age 80, he might not. So the DSP needs to make a very swift decision, since this whole process is taking roughly 100 milliseconds, 150 milliseconds, tops. Cool. So how do DSPs actually make a living? There are three business models, either the CPM, which is cost per impression, meaning that they get a dime every time that someone sees an app, an ad, or they get paid by a click, if the user clicks an ad. And the last model is called CPA, if the user does some sort of an action, installs an app, buys something, rides an Uber, whatever. The most popular one is CPC, cost per click. And with CPC, it's kind of in the middle between taking no risk, only paying for an impression, and taking all the risk, right? Only paying if the user rides an app or does something. However, most of the users don't click, right? I guess that you all have seen, I don't know, 100 ads since you woke this morning, and you probably didn't click most of them. So it's a very, very rare event. And a DSP makes money only if the user clicks. So it's an imbalanced data. There's a lot of interesting computers, a lot of interesting data science problems. Okay, now pricing is a really challenging problem. If you're a DSP and you want to actually bid, you can try and rely on user features on the advertiser, like is it Coca-Cola or Tinder, is it a dating app? But you also have the context, right? Where is the user actually at? Is he on a mobile app, like trying to learn Korean, or is he on Facebook trying to chat with his friends? So the hosting app is really a crucial part of the whole bid price. Now, one fact on pricing is that if you are trying to bid on very popular apps, then you're going to pay a lot. Anyone can try and bid or advertise on Google or Facebook, but that's costly. If you were to bid, for example, on this very esoteric app for learning Korean, then you're going to pay peanuts. And if you're actually trying to advertise something that's relevant to someone who's trying to learn Korean, then you're going to make a lot of money. Right, so we're trying to find the best match and the cheapest one. Mm-hmm. So this is the idea. Let's assume that we can run ChatGPT on all the apps in the App Store. Right, and we can just ask it any question we'd like. Right, is this app related to someone learning Korean? Is this app on the Squid Game? And you can be as elaborate as you'd like because we're running ChatGPT here. So that's like the fantasy. However, it's very costly, right? ChatGPT is not free and you pay quite a lot per token. And it's something that's pretty hard to scale. So the main idea is also to kind of force ChatGPT to output a structured answer, like a yes or a no, because ChatGPT can be very talkative. Any question and the answer, please. So there are a lot of challenges. How can we scale it and like get the most bang for our buck? And this is actually the result. We launched a service called AdVac that does exactly that. You can ask any question and you get this neat Excel sheet with like checkboxes. Is this app for kids? Is it for a dating app? Is it advertising alcohol? You can do anything, any question you'd like, right? And then you can just target those users who are using those apps, and pretty useful. And let's talk how this kind of service could actually work on a scalable way without losing your pants in the way. Before that, a brief intro about LLM and how they work under the hood. So LLM have three parts. They have the tokenizer. Tokenizer is a function that takes a string and splits it into tokens. More on that in a second. We have the transformer, the poster child of the LLM. It gets the most love, most of the attention, but it's the least important. Most companies are not going to train a transformer. And if you're working for Facebook or Google, then probably you do, but we are not going to train a transformer. And the last part is the decoding algorithm, which I think gets the least attention. It's very useful. You can do a lot of amazing stuff if you just change the decoding algorithm. So this would be the focus for today's talk. First of all, what is a tokenizer? So a tokenizer tries to split a string into words, and we'll correct that in a second, because there's this kind of philosophical debate, what is a word? And it is a philosophical debate. And as machine learning folks, we don't really want to get into that. But just for the heck of it, is New York two words or one? So it's definitely a concept, right? It has a white space in the middle, but splitting it by a white space is not enough. So there are a lot of things that we need to take into account. And you have some of the examples here. Now, there are two extremes on how we can split a string into a list of tokens. One of them is just, let's use the alphabet, right? We have 26 letters in the English alphabet. That's a valid split. That's how we humans actually understand texts. And that's a valid point, but that doesn't work with transformers. And that's an empirical fact. It's not right. There's no reason. For some reason, transformers don't work super well with character level tokenization. The other extreme is to just split by white space, like to have a token be a word in a dictionary. That's also an alternative. The downside of this approach is that you're going to have a huge vocabulary, which means that you need a lot of data, and also a statistical phenomenon, new words tend to spring into existence all of the time. So you have an open set, and then you need to deal with the out of vocabulary problem constantly. So we want some sort of a compromise, and one algorithm called the word piece, there's also other. Word pieces is the algorithm used by BERT. And for example, this is how BERT splits a sentence, this sentence, it was overall unremarkable, into tokens. So it makes some sense, but not completely, right? It was overall un, so far seemed to make sense for us humans. And then rim, arc. If I were to split the sentence, it would be re-mark, right? Mark seemed to be the stem here. But it doesn't really matter. So the way these algorithms actually work, they train some sort of a statistical test on a character level. You can think like a chi-square test, or it doesn't really matter. And if a sequence of characters is statistically significant, not random, then we add it to the vocabulary. So essentially, all of the characters are valid word pieces, and we have some more. And the second part is the transformer. I'm not going to say too much about it. We had the revolutionary paper, attention is all you need, and yada, yada, yada. Too many people speak about transformers. And quite frankly, I don't think it's that important, right? We have plenty of transformers. You wake up someday, you just take the best one. It's not something you really need to worry about. Now, the third part. We have the decoder, which I think is where the magic happens. So before we drill down on how the decoder actually works, there are two ways on how we can train a transformer. We can either train it with the masked language model objective, which means that we train it to complete words in the middle of the sentence. It's very useful for a lot of things, for example, classification. It's not useful for generation, right? So a lot of models like Roberta, DiBerta are very useful, and they are relatively small, but less useful for generation. And we have the causal language model, which always predicts the last word. Okay, so assuming that we have the causal language model that assigns probabilities or logits to the next probable token, we can just apply some sort of a greedy search, right, and take the next most likely word. For example, if my input prompt is I am a virtual mask, then it could be I'm a virtual assistant, I'm a virtual machine. But you need to keep in mind that all of the words in the vocabulary, all of the tokens in the vocabulary have probabilities, right? So I'm a virtual salami also have some sort of probability mass, right? So what if we play with this algorithm and not take only the maximal one, right? So the maximal one is called a greedy search algorithm. The most common approach is called a beam search, but we can also put some constraints on the decoding algorithm. One very common use case is when we're trying to generate a formal language. So let's assume that my input prompt is this syntax. It's a C command for int whatever. The only next valid tokens are the comparison operators, right? Nothing else is valid in this context. So it doesn't really make any sense to look at variable names like salami, right? It's not something that would compile. So if I want to force my LLM to create a syntactically correct output, then I need to essentially have my own decoder. But we can use this trick, and this trick is called the verbalizer, also for classification. Let's assume that this is the input prompt. Candy Crush is an app 4, and the only valid tokens here are the App Store categories, right? So essentially, I ask the model, from these categories, choose the most likely one. And this is also super cheap, because I only ask ChatGPT or my transformer to generate one token. And if you know anything about how ChatGPT actually builds, then it builds by the token, right?
Yeah, but you're sending
token. Question at the end. Cool. So, do you want to see some code? So, here, there's a link with a lot more examples than what I'm going to show here. And it's actually a part, we had a workshop for the reserve duty soldiers, back then for free. And this is the materials from that workshop. So you can actually play with more than the code snippets I'm going to show here. Some interesting fact about the way the OpenAI tokenizer work. If you go to this link, which is actually freely available if you just Google OpenAI tokenizer, you see that OpenAI tokenizes strings kind of differently. This is the input prompt, yes, at various cases. And if you take a closer look, you see that the first yes and the second yes have different token IDs, which is very uncommon. You don't see that in a lot of models in Hugging Face, but it does seem that for some reason, OpenAI have a different token ID for all of the words in the vocabulary if they appear on the first on the sentence, which is interesting. And each case, so OpenAI ARC case sensitive, as it seems, right? But if I try a very unusual casing, like lowercase y with an ES, then it's been split into two tokens. So that's not something that OpenAI has seen statistically significant amount of times in the internet or whatever was the training set. Cool, so if we know all of the token IDs, we can just list them here. And keep in mind that GPT-3 and GPT-4 token IDs are different. Apparently, we can just fire an API request for using their PyPI module with temperature equals zero, which means that I don't want any random selection, just be deterministic. This is where I plug in the bias, meaning I'm adding 100, which 100 with logits is like an infinity. It's a huge amount for these tokens. Asking ChatGPT to choose from these tokens. And I also ask it to generate only one token. Again, very, very cheap, right? Very cost effective, very accurate. And only those tokens are going to be selected. So this is how we turned OpenAI ChatGPT into a fancy classifier. And you can do the same with Hugging Face, with any models you find there. It's a bit more complicated with Hugging Face because you need to do it yourself, you need to reshape the logits. Again, it's not rocket science, but again, you can turn any transformer model into a classifier using this verbalizer trick. And if you're trying to do something a bit more fancy than just classifier, let's say you want to generate a whole text with some constraints, like the example that we've seen with the for loop. You can do that with a library like Guidance, and there are other alternatives, like Outlines, JSON Former. OpenAI also has its own OpenAI function calls. For example, in this prompt, I ask it to classify, but with their own operator. Like solitaire grand harvest is a, and select from this list. And they support a lot of things. They support regular expressions and other really cool things. So Guidance, by the way, by Microsoft, is an amazing library. You should definitely look into it. So that's it. As Eitan mentioned, I really like to end each presentation with with something you can Google, right? So I hope that you would Google verbalizers. It's a really cool concept. I hope I convinced you that constrained search is the way to go in most cases. Very cheap, very easy to implement. And in most cases, we don't really want to let ChatGPT do whatever. We want it to predict some sort of structure that we can use down the line in some other part of the pipeline, right? So we really want structured data. That's it. Thank you. Yeah.
The use of a verbalizer or constrained search, how much does it affect the pricing of calling OpenAI? And if you can also mention how the pricing of OpenAI works.
So they charge you for input tokens and output tokens. So if you're going to ask a longest prompt, then maybe not as much, but at least you know it's not going to, it's going to be deterministic. Each question is only one output token.
And the output is more expensive than the input, so it's better.
Yeah.
Did you compare ChatGPT model to some open source models? Because classification problem is much easier than generation problem, and maybe open source like Llama V2 will be great enough.
So the question was, did I compare ChatGPT to other models since classification is an easier task? We did partially. So the web is kind of full with people comparing ChatGPT, like on a daily basis. But yeah, definitely, it's not the easiest way to do classification.
ChatGPT is not update. It takes time to update it. Is it looking through the mobile app store? You're running it on a mobile app store. How do you? He doesn't know it. He doesn't know how to search, right?
Right. So the question was, how does ChatGPT actually know the mobile app store? It doesn't. So we download all of the descriptions from the mobile app store. On the prompt, we asked it, giving the following description. Blah, blah, blah. Is this app for kids? Is this app for grown-ups? Is this app, whatever?
Kind of a follow-up to that he said. ChatGPT and I think all LLMs are really, really good in transforming data. Don't count on the internal model data. For example, here, GV, the description, everything, don't, even if it's a generic concept that it should know, never count on its internal data. That's when you get hallucinations.
Any other questions?
Is there any particular benefit of using like a library that you showed rather than just making specific in the prompt what the output should look like why or no, because it's also possible?
So this is an amazing question. Like essentially what he asks is, why should I really care? Can't I just ask ChatGPT, please output it with this format?
Output Y or N.
That's yeah, please stick to this format, Y or N. Uh-huh. And I didn't show, but there are a lot of very fun examples. For example, I tried to ask it, like, if you were Harry Potter, is it okay to kill Lord Voldemort? And in most cases, it never outputs yes or no, no matter how you prompt it. Mm-hmm. It answers some politically correct answers like, as an AI model, I cannot, killing is wrong, I don't know, given the consequences. So it's not something you can rely on from an engineering point of view. Yeah.
Would it be better to get full logic if it's possible instead of just getting this is the best answer?
So another great question.
Like to get the logic for yes is 0.7 and the logic for no is 0.5.
So the question was, do I need the exact value of the logits? And they are definitely fancier.
Is it better to get the exact values?
So this is deep learning. We don't know ever if something is better than something else. We just try everything. So yeah, last question. Yeah.
Can you talk more about Argmax? Like what services you offer? What do you do?
Sure. So you're asking for the pitch. Yeah, we specialize in recommendation systems and natural language processing. Most of our clients are some way or another related to marketing, advertising, since they care about recommendation systems and matching users with products or ads. obviously I can talk about Argmax for a while, but I want to spare everyone's time. Okay, thank you so much. It's not trivial.